You have to do audience and practice and story together.
Initial practice is a start, and practice is cultural practice.
Examples of women
sharing. What is it that you do? Sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
We're from all our religion. We can see you talk about what time is it now in Kenya.
It started out about different people and about different things.
A whole sea of phenomena.
Theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's it, what should be done.
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death has already changed.
So thank you everybody for coming out for the final performance today of the Pinwheeled Voices Festival. It's a fantastic lineup of great writers, eight writers from all over the planet. And these are not emerging writers, they're great, great, great masters of their field. And they're coming from Japan, South Africa, from Croatia, Sweden, and Israel, and many, many other countries. Again, thank you for coming. I'm Frank Hentschker, the Executive Director and Director of Programs at the Center B Bridge Academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And the Pinwheeled Voices Festival for 10 years now has been a real part of our programming. When they started the festival and there were no playwrights in it, I wrote them for 2 years, said, you have poets, you have short story writers, we need playwrights in there. They got even Nobel Prizes once in a while. So this is a fantastic thing, and Penn is a great organization, and it's a real honor for us that we are connected to this. This evening is extremely special for us for two things. First, Shahid Nadeem, the playwright, he flew in from Pakistan to be with us. Maybe you wave, and he's been back after 5 or 6 years. You were here with a play, so thank you. He's one of the great writers of this planet, of this world. This play was a very interesting production in London, a surprise, a hit, one might even say. And so this is a really unique thing. Tanya Ronder did an adaptation from it based on his play. They collaborated to adapt it, you know, also for our eyes. We everywhere is different, and theater is often like a homeopathic pill, you know. So it has to be a little bit different where it works. And of course, we are so honored that Oscar is with us, great Oscar Eustace, who directed this play, and that he took time out of his busy life. And if you, this is really a busy life, what he has, but also a great creative life. So congratulations on all your work. And it's the greatest honor that you said, you know, come for Shahid, for Tanya, but also for the Segal Center and the Graduate Center here. So it's a great honor. If you have a cell phone, take it out for one moment, and I will do the same. And just make sure it's off. So that it says... it never rings in our performances, so just make sure it's off. Yeah. Okay, so thank you very, very much. And now we have Dara by Shahid Nadeem, adaptation from Tanya Ronder, directed by Oscar Eustace. Thank you.
Scene 1. Dara, 44, in a thin linen tunic, bangs on a huge door. He is half wild with hunger and exhaustion. It is early 1659, Bengal, India.
Open up!
Announce yourself, sir!
Fetch your master!
Watchman opens a hatch in the door.
Your name, sir? I can't hear you. You have to shout through. It's wood. It's very heavy door.
The servant speaks to another servant inside.
He won't give his name.
Why not?
I don't know.
Can you tell us who you are, sir?
Malik Jawan will know. I am no foe. Fetch him.
We can't, sir, without your name.
Open. Will you?
If we can just take your...
I'm not giving it to you. Get your master.
Sapir, a boy of 13, joins Dara.
Without the usual pageant, they want my name, pushing me to pass through some commonplace door.
Father.
Even releasing a lock seems beyond me these days.
That's right on. It's half the day to Persia.
I know where we are. We need help.
Food?
Not just food. Malik has gold to give Sapir. We cannot turn up as beggars in Persia, stinking in defeat. They're friends, yes, but still we need a rock, a foundation upon which to build a new army.
Do you trust Malik?
I saved his life, Sapir.
But is he trustworthy?
What are we jeopardizing? There's nothing left to take.
There is you. That is left to take.
We could all be taken at any moment, whenever Allah sees fit. We have no choice. We have to stop Aurangzeb, Sapir, or our empire will petrify. He is a blinkering bigot, a narrower vision of Islam never existed. We will all be driven underground.
Who's there?
Malik Jawan.
What do you want?
A harmonious kingdom, a glass of water. It's a difficult question to answer.
The door creaks open.
I know how I must look.
Is that Prince Dara?
Emperor Dara, according to my father, but he is imprisoned in his own palace. I am Shahazazan's crown prince.
A sudden movement. Sapir emerges from the shadows.
Defend!
Malik's men position themselves armed.
It's my son, Malik Jawan, my son, Sapir. The bravest of youths, his current garb does not represent his qualities, but which exterior was ever eloquent about the pearl within?
Greetings, Sir Jawan.
Where are your men?
All in all, we are 30.
30?
The best 30, the apostles of loyalty. A month ago, we were 1,000 times that many, but now we are without military escort.
Who drives you to this, Prince Dara?
My brother, Malik Jawan.
Prince Aurangzeb.
He has Delhi, he has Argo Fort surrounded. My father and sister, Jahanara, beyond my care's reach, inside. He uses my home for his family, whilst his fast-swelling army haunts us down. Baby brother, Murad, in tow. Aurangzeb claims no interest in the throne, yet he craves it undeservedly. But our father, the emperor, still lives, so I will not let him take it.
You have always been brave, Prince Dara.
To bluster, Malik Jawan, part grief, part fear, mostly fury. I am gripped with hatred for Aurangzeb. I never have been for anyone.
Allah tests you, Prince.
And I am ready. We need a night or two under your roof before we march through the Bolan Pass to regroup. We might have reached Persia weeks ago if my wife.
Your beloved princess.
The remainder of our army returned to Lahore with my mother's body.
Allah may she rest in peace.
They buried her next to her Sufi master, Myung Mir's tomb.
Digging in the dark like thieves because we are Aurangzeb's enemies now. No Sufi is safe.
I'm sorry.
Nadira has no stomach for war. The less one has, the closer one is to God, yet this death punches the bliss for me. But here you are at the edge of our empire.
And here we stand talking in the dark. Come in, Prince, you are welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you, Malik Jawan.
I'd not be here were it not for you, Prince. I'd have been crunched under your father's formidable elephant.
Please, let us follow you in.
Act 1, Scene 2. Aurangzeb, 42, carefully unfolds a prayer mat. A muezzin sings the call to prayer in the gaps of song. Here abide, a girl, another time, another place. A memory of Aurangzeb sings a Hindu song. Aurangzeb prays. He is in a large tent pitched amongst his army. Here abide sings again. Aurangzeb, distracted by her, turns to look. His attention is snapped back by Murad, appearing at the entrance of his tent, his aide behind him. Aurangzeb completes his prayers, rolls up his mat, greets Murad warmly.
Brother.
Aurangzeb.
I'm glad you came. Please join me. My man will fetch your man some tea.
He stays.
Then we shall have tea brought. and wine for you, Morel.
Are you drinking?
We must celebrate, Your Highness.
How, Your Holiness? You never indulge.
In alcohol, no.
Imad Aurangzeb's secretary brings Murad wine and his aide tea.
You must sometimes want the taste in your mouth.
Not at all.
I could drink all day long. Was it Grandfather Jahangir who put you off?
I don't need a human specter.
Just the cautions of the Quran. When he diluted his rum to slow his decay, he thinned it not with water, as a wise man would, but with wine, confirming that alcohol weakens the intellect. Not as much as opium, admittedly, which Grandfather was also partial to, but you saw all that.
I don't remember much.
Really? Finished imbibing by late morning? Was fast asleep by lunch, propped up on cushions like a whore? He drank, his wife ruled. You lived there for 2 whole years.
Is the wine good? Would you like some more?
Why don't you mind that I drink?
Because you're a soldier to the core. That's who you are. They don't understand you at court. They haven't grasped that the worm turned long ago.
I don't need your protection, Aurangzeb. I know what they say, and I know what they'll be thinking when they bow to me.
They need to look in your eyes to see the boldness.
My timorid plot.
Stronger in you, Murad, than the rest of us put together.
It's worth remembering that, Aurangzeb.
More.
Aurangzeb pours wine.
Why did you rush ahead?
Why did you stay behind?
You, the
astrologers said it was auspicious to forge forwards. We had to respond quickly.
You made me question our arrangement. We were fighting side by side, and suddenly, without warning, my men were at the back like sheep.
I am impatient to deliver you to Delhi, brother, to have your name emblazoned on the coins. You got my letters?
I got 3.
Murad, you were perfectly right. The Indian Empire, all of Hindustan, is thirsty for this change.
Why not you? What stops you from ruling?
I am not a king. But whilst I wish my brother well, I will not sit back and watch Dara take the throne.
Because you would dissipate our religion.
Dilute and dissipate. His religious observance is lax.
And mine is not.
You do not spend your days writing mystical poetry.
Did you see his soldiers? That wasn't an army. It was a collection of bakers and cobblers with swords. You know, when he writes, he still addresses me as baby brother.
I serve my empire by placing an emperor I believe in on the peacock throne. Then show me a room and let me devour the words of Allah and his prophet, may peace be upon him, for the rest of my days.
Where do you envisage this room being?
Wherever you see fit, Your Highness. I trust you, brother. I serve you well in this war.
The people of Delhi adore Dara.
He throws money at them. Of course they love him.
Can I trust you? Where's your holy book?
Here.
He brings out his Quran.
I thought you memorized it long ago.
Still, it is always with me.
Swear on it.
Swear what?
What you will.
Aurangzeb places his hand on the Quran.
I swear that I am working in your best interest to deliver what our empire needs most. You at its helm.
You didn't spit on that in a hurry.
Stay. I can offer the massage services of an expert slave girl.
Is she good?
Very. My tent is yours, brother. Anything you need.
A girl comes in.
May I remove your boots, sir?
He is perfectly safe.
I'll stay if you don't mind, sir.
Of course.
Murad, giving himself over to his massage, expels a sound of deep satisfaction. Aurangzeb leaves. In Act 1, Scene 3, Malik betrays Dara, handing him over to his brother, Aurangzeb's men. Sapir manages to escape. In Act 1, Scene 4, Aurangzeb betrays Murad, Garrett garroting his aide and carting Murad off to prison. Act 1, Scene 5. In Agra Fort, Shah Jahan rails against a letter.
Is he coming here?
Aurangzeb hasn't the decency to face me. Sending me orders from Delhi, incompetent to rule, how dare he?
He wants it all, Baba. Your place on the throne and everything that goes with it.
I'm not finished yet. And when the time comes, I've chosen my successor.
You know it never unfolds like that, Baba. Every one of your sons is a contender.
What are you saying, Jahanara? I should have killed the others off?
No, Baba, but this is war. All those lives. It's insatiable.
What can we do from here?
Wait. is all, as ever.
Until Dara returns to march on Aurangzeb.
You don't even know where Dara is. He may be months away. How can we know?
Little white snake. It's not enough to have me trapped here like a bear. Aurangzeb wants my fort. He knows the jewels I have in my cellars.
Stop it, Father. What can you offer? Send Aurangzeb something. Create time for us to think.
A glass of poison. Look what he's doing to me.
And what did you do to your own kin when you were in Aurangzeb's position? Your surviving brother? Your nephews and cousins? Family blood has been shed on accession before you, Baba. What about your sword?
Alamgir. You mean Alamgir?
Yes, Alamgir. That would please him.
It is a sword built for an emperor. It is mine.
I know, Baba, but we have to work with him, not against him.
What if Dara comes?
Then everything would change.
I need a girl. Fetch me a girl, Jahanara.
Which one?
Sweetmeats are tasty, whichever stall they're from.
It's not good for you, Baba. It is a stress on your body.
So give me more silver oil to keep in her eye. I'm a loving man, Jahanara.
I know, Baba, the most loving. But you are getting old.
Not old. Not yet. I'm not done yet.
Act 1, Scene 6. In the Red Fort in Delhi, Aurangzeb is presented with Alamgir.
A sword?
The blade he's always used.
The one we weren't allowed to touch as children?
You can touch it now.
May I hold it?
Yes, but don't drop it.
I won't. Caesar of the universe.
Stop it, What's funny? It's the sword's name, it's not mine.
But it will be yours. Murad's captured, Dara's captured, father's confined. Why has he sent it?
Buying time for Dara, as ever.
Oh, then he's spending money in an empty shop.
Imad enters.
Lord.
Bows deeply.
Prince Dara is a day away.
Fine, good. Imad.
Yes, sir.
Before they enter Delhi, they must change elephants.
Yes, sir.
You know Babita?
Babita is sick, sire.
I want Dara to ride on that elephant, just as she is. And Sipa here?
No news as yet, sire.
Aurangzeb dismisses Imad. Roshanara hands back the sword.
What must Dara be thinking?
Humiliation is new to him. He's still sticky with our mother's milk.
Father should watch. And Jahanara, can't you bring them from Agra?
I don't have access to him yet. And anyway, his days of appearing in public are over.
So father will end his days in a fort the size of a walled city?
In the harem of Agra Fort. I will limit him to that section as soon as we can.
The women's quarters, how fitting.
Roshanara, you need to control yourself. It is not apposite to interrupt an empire.
Oh, I'm sorry, Your Highness.
Allow me to offer you some wisdom. The key to conquering the self lies in restraint.
I apologize. Please continue.
My plan is to lock father in his own harem as soon as we gain entry.
Well, why don't you just attack? Go in.
And destroy those towering walls which are now mine.
You need him to surrender. Beg for mercy. How much food do they have?
The kitchens are full.
So as long as they have water and enough to eat. What? Oh. You can drive them out with furs. Imad!
In a flow of water, we catch a snatch of Hirabai learning how to wash before prayer. Aurangzeb is caught by the memory.
Three times. Swish and spit. Three times.
Hira is a mischievous and squirts the water sideways to Aurangzeb.
Act 1, Scene 7. In Agra, Jahanara interrogates a servant girl.
The pipes cannot all be empty. Try the bathing rooms again.
They're dry, my lady. All of them dry.
Everything is lost if there is no water. We cannot cook, we cannot drink, we cannot pray.
Emperor Aurangzeb must know this, my lady.
How could he? Are you not scared to die, Afia?
Not yet, my lady.
Why?
Because I trust that you will leave the fort and beg your brother on your father's behalf for water.
What else can I do, Afia?
I think Emperor Aurangzeb must know this too, my lady. He understands you have no option.
Your deaths would be on my hands. My father's, yours, your children's. Of course. First I must go beg him. I know he knows. He has us all now.
Act 2, Scene 1, The Past. For a moment, we see all four siblings and their younger counterparts linked. Jahanara gives way to her younger self, young Jahanara, 14. Young Roshanara, 11, joins her. It's 30 years earlier, 1629, the Red Fort, Delhi. There is drumming from the drum room, a slave girl sweeps the great hall with a brush of branches, a male servant squatting cleans between the floor tiles. Swallows swoop and twitter through the open hall. A slave rushes by with towels. The girls follow her.
Not yet!
She just has baby after baby.
They are your brothers and sisters, Roshanara.
Each one makes her weaker, even when the baby doesn't live.
What do you suggest? She stops having children?
There are enough of us already, aren't there?
Roshanara!
You know what's gonna happen if she dies, don't you?
I can't believe you just said that.
Everybody dies. Even emperor's wives.
You need to be quiet.
You'll be in charge. First lady of the empire. You'll make all the decisions and everyone will forget about me.
Don't talk to me when you're in this mood.
Young Roshanara plumps herself down.
I was gonna sit there. I wish they'd bring news.
It's probably another girl. Why are you smiling?
Because your babies are adorable. Not like you, Grumpy. What's the matter?
I'm bored!
It always feels this way when we have to wait.
Wouldn't if we were boys.
What would you do if you were a boy?
Go outside, run, fight.
You know what I would do?
Calligraphy.
I'd marry.
Do you want to get married?
Sometimes.
And have children?
Yes.
I'm glad we can't. If you have boys, they grow up more powerful than you. With girls, they end up hating you.
I don't hate Ami.
Have you met someone?
Rare. We never get the chance, but that might change when Dara is emperor. Have you?
What?
Met someone? I don't believe it. Roshanara, how? You're 11 years old.
You're 14, catch up.
Itbar, a eunuch, comes in with an infant's jacket.
Girls talk, Itbar.
Am I not a girl?
Well, you're a eunuch.
Do you want to be a girl?
Not really.
Well then, you're a man, and can't join in our conversation.
The boys run in. As they pass the water, young Dara, 13, splashes young Aurangzeb, 11.
Don't,
what?
Dara!
What did I do?
He splashed me!
Calm down, boys.
Look, you always do this when father's coming.
You're always so serious when father's coming.
No, I'm not!
Young Roshanara splashes young Dara. He, in good humor, splashes her back.
Hey, you helped me!
Yeah, I'm a better aim than you. Would you like my jacket?
No, because then I'll look like a boy.
Young Dara points the jacket Iqbar is holding.
Take Marat's! Wear your baby brother's jacket!
Would you like mine, Roshanara?
Roshanara splashes Dara again.
Roshanara!
What?
Shah Jahan enters.
Gather around.
Baba,
what happened, father?
We have a song to prepare all the way from France. It's for your mother. Hmm? Who can tell me where France is?
It's close to that little island.
The British Isles.
And the monarch?
King Charles.
No, Petal. He rules the little isles. Who rules France? Hmm?
Servant enters.
Excuse me, Your Excellency. A fakir is here, carrying apples.
Show him in.
The servant goes out backwards, never turning his back on the emperor. The girls cover their faces with veils.
King Louis XIII.
Ah, Louis the Just!
The servant returns with a young fakir with long, uncovered hair and a little, very little on. He holds apples.
Two red apples? How?
Trees, my lord.
Which trees?
They are invisible to some eyes.
My pregnant wife yearned for apples. I've had every tree in Kashmir investigated. The entire region, nothing is in season. Yet you arrive with two shiny apples. Where is your tree?
Oh, it's not my tree, sire. I possess nothing but what you see me in.
Yet you bring more than gold.
May I ask you a question, sire?
Go.
Smell your hands. What do they smell of?
Apples. The distinct smell of these beautiful fruits.
Whenever you suffer ill health, sire, inhale the odor from your hands. If you still smell the scent of apples, you have longer to live. But when you cease to smell apples, your life has reached its term.
Will it be sickness, Fakir? Will I die a natural death?
I cannot tell you that, sire. I can only see what I see.
Which is more than you say. I charge you a question. Which son of mine, born or unborn, will destroy my bloodline?
I'm sorry, sire.
Answer.
That is unfair to ask, sire, and with your two sons present.
Nonetheless, it is a question I pose.
They are just boys.
They are princes. Princes have ears of flint. Answer the question, I command you.
What if I were wrong, sire?
You could lie to me, or you could tell me what you see. But if you do neither, you will not live beyond sundown.
The middle of your living sons? The one with pale skin?
Aurangzeb?
I beg you, sire, but please, go.
Come here, Aurangzeb. Did you hear what the fakir said?
Yes, father.
Are you going to destroy me one day, boy? Well?
No, father.
You had better not, you little snake. Do you hear?
Why would he, father?
Why would I?
You better had not. Take these apples to my wife. Give them to the ladies. Run.
The servant bows, takes the apples, and leaves, running backwards. Shah Jahan smells his hands.
I don't know what sort of magic it is you practice, but I'm grateful.
Oh, no magic, your lordship. I didn't mean to misguide you. I follow the prophets, may peace be upon him, path of love. Every one of us, within Allah's measure, can open our fate up. Like a flower, lift up to the sun and broaden our way.
Don't leave without filling your purse.
Well, I don't have need of money, sire.
Oh, food then.
Nor food, sire. Thank you.
He wants for nothing. Show him out.
Goodbye, children of the Empire. Forgive my imprudence. Remember, rock is the same as jewel. Only the latter holds life.
The fakir leaves with the servant backwards.
Who was he? Father, who was that fakir?
I met him on the mosque steps.
How can Sufis see like that?
See what?
Everything!
They see nothing, nothing!
How can he be a Muslim, Baba? He didn't even have clothes on.
He's not a real Muslim.
Clothes are irrelevant.
Not in the Quran.
It's a different kind of Muslim.
I'd rather that than the mullah's long cloaks.
The best garment is the garment of righteousness.
See? Quran.
Was it righteous?
Take him to the courtyard or wherever his baby brother is.
Yes, sire.
He's not a snake. You're all snakes!
Aurangzeb!
Ignore them! Dara. My watermelon. And Jahanara, a fresh spring. Come.
He leads them off. Act 2, Scene 2. The past. A burst of flames. 1644, 15 years later, young Jahanara gives way to Jahanara, who is bundled off. Itbar and the fakir are mid-30s, speaking in hushed, hurried tones.
A lamp set the princess alight.
It wasn't properly in its alcove. Her dress and hijab went up like kindling. Two slave girls died trying to smother the flames. The emperor throws doctor after doctor at her, local, foreign, now you.
If I can be of any service.
Princess Jahanara will live or die. We cannot influence which. It is Shah Jahan who needs help. Losing his wife, Mumtaz nearly slew him. Were Jahanara to go too, he would crawl into his grave. He mused like a kitten by her side. His children are gathering. Dara has been at her bedside since the accident.
Is Aurangzeb?
No, not here yet. No apples today?
There was no request for fruit.
Next time you're summoned, in another 15 years, His Majesty's favorite is watermelon and is partial to mango. Let's go. Just to warn you, her wounds go through muscle and fat to bone. Her left arm is under question whether they should amputate.
Has the ice arrived?
Excuse us, slaves fetch a daily supply from the mountains. My lady is concerned with their tardiness.
Are you being disrespectful, Iqbar?
My lady?
Tell me as soon as it gets here.
Eager to prove what a fine first lady she would make.
Has the Emperor stopped his building work?
The Taj Mahal. A week of inactivity, but the rain is coming, so they are back at it now. They have to waterproof it, which means immersing each and every brick in scalding fat.
That must be costly.
Mustn't it?
Aurangzeb, 27, arrives.
Where is my sister?
Prince Aurangzeb, welcome home.
Thank you, Ibtar. What is this fakir doing here?
Salam alaikum, sire. I am happy to see
you. Did father summon him?
He did.
Send him home. We do not want you here.
It may be polite to wait and see your father.
I said leave, you worshipper of idols.
I'm a Sufi, sire. A Muslim, not a Hindu.
How dare you call your naked dancing Islam?
We dance for love of Allah and his prophet, may peace be upon him, with ecstasy in our hearts.
I do not acknowledge that Islam.
Dara, 29, and Shah Jahan, 52, hurry in.
No sooner. Muslim
bows deeply, fakir follows suit.
No sooner have you crossed my threshold than you see fit to abuse my guests.
Salam, brother. When did you arrive?
Salam alaikum, your highness.
Why don't I show you to my apartment? You can freshen up.
I feel safer in an apartment of my own.
Safer?
You have rooms of your own within mine. Our sections of the fort is newly built. It's secure.
I see you plowed your funds into the building works, father. I passed the semi-constructed mausoleum.
How dare you travel all this distance to pour insidious allegations on your family? Huh? Unsafe in your own brother's home?
I came to see my sister.
The fire was 3 weeks ago.
It's the first invitation in 8 years that you've extended me.
You've been engaged in other business.
I have, and the Deccan thrives under my leadership.
So do its mango trees, which you have kept close.
I have sent fruits of every crop.
Do you think I don't know? You keep the best for yourself.
I would like to see my sister
now. She's sleeping.
You will pay for this haughty and ridiculous attitude. How dare you mistrust us? Take off your sword.
Why?
I'm stripping you of office.
Ah, father!
You are no longer in charge of the Deccan. Ex-Viceroy!
He did not mean to offend, father.
If ousting a conspiracy for fratricide is offensive, then so be it.
Aurangzeb takes off his sword and strides off.
Your Majesty, do you mind if I speak with your son?
I do not ever want to see you again.
Let me talk with you, son.
You should have been killed a decade ago.
Never trust a snake in the grass.
Aurangzeb, come home with me, see the family.
It was wrong to say what I saw. I should have chosen death.
Yes, you should have.
Aurangzeb,
God will know our hearts.
Aurangzeb leaves. Act 2, Scene 3. We are back in 1659. Jahanara and Shah Jahan are led to a small room at the top of the Harem Tower of Agra Fort.
Dara behind bars?
It will be me looking after things for you now.
Shah Jahan removes his jewels and hands them to Iqbar. Iqbar gives them to a servant who carries them off.
How comforting to have an old friend as a jailer. Spit it out then, Iqbar. Don't spare the details.
I never saw a greater crowd, sire, not even on your coronation. There were no flowers left in the marketplace, not a bloom. Every rooftop was crammed, all thirsting for a glimpse of the broken prince.
Is Dara broken, Iqbar?
As he passed, his petite elephant lumbering her scabbed feet through the fetid streets, they roared their outrage from those rooms and windows. Every shadowy corner, Dara, Dara, set Dara free. The elephant's legs shook with every step. She'd not been washed in weeks.
Oh, Aurangzeb.
You would have been warmed by the weeping, sire, as your people saw their hopes of Prince Dara replacing you recede. The soothsaying fakir, who once brought you apples, danced half-naked, intoning, "Today is Dara's coronation. Emperor Dara is carried to his throne."
If only.
And the whole crowd crooned, "Emperor Dara, Emperor Dara." Many thousands, all different religions.
And Dara?
Like a snapped twig, ma'am. Without the will to even lift his head.
I knew it. I felt it.
How can a brother do this?
Where is he now?
In a cell under the Red Fort.
I can't sit here. Like a stuffed animal.
How irritating to be confined, sire, after so many years of liberty. But your tower is pleasant. And one of the peaks in what was once your fort, at least you can enjoy a view of your Taj Mahal.
Stop it, Iqbar. For all time's sake.
I can barely see the cursed thing.
Oh, sire, don't call it cursed.
Iqbar.
Why is everything being obliterated? My eyes, my son. Leave us, Iqbar.
I'm sorry, sire.
Leave us, please.
Of course, sire. I may be your jailer, but I can still take instruction for old time's sake.
Shah Jahan looks toward the Taj.
It proved to be merely the shadow of a woman who died too young.
Some shadow, Baba. It's a physical poem, and you know it. The most exquisite monument ever.
A ghost is all. Spectre white against the red of life. Its towers are spindly arms outstretched to Allah, to our children. The arch in the middle is mine, all mine. Welcoming me to our inner self, so intricate and wise. Imposing, yet contained. She stood sentry to our lives, springing to life when you broached her. Vivid curls of green tendrils and blood-red flowers. I miss her so much.
I know.
I held my softness for her.
Yes, Papa. And some for me.
Act 2, Scene 4. The throne room of the Red Fort Delhi. Aurangzeb sits on the peacock throne, meters above his figures.
Roshanar, what is it?
Sire, Malik Juwan has been attacked by the crowd.
Malik Juwan?
They hate him for handing Dara over. What happened?
He was riding down Chandichok. Apparently, at first, there were just a few jeers, then a woman threw muck at him. Then everybody joined in with stones, pots, and from the high-up windows, the contents of their latrines. Our soldiers beat back the crowd, then brought him to the royal guest house.
He's here now?
Yes.
Release him.
Unprotected, Your Majesty, the crowd will kill him.
They want meat, so give them meat.
The man betrayed his benefactor. It would not be long before he deceived us too. Now, to the matter at hand, my brother in our dungeons. Anyone?
Your Holy Majesty, he struggled hard for rights within this family. And look at it now. 60 days on a camel's back to cross your empire, sire, from the Deccan to Kashmir, from Bengal to the Punjab, everything is yours. Your father wasted resources on opulent monuments, but you, sire, will expand and consolidate the empire.
Don't flatter me, cousin.
I wouldn't.
Don't be so salty that I have to spit you out, nor so cloying that I choke on you.
So long as Prince Dara lives, in or out of prison, he could incite mutiny. Sire, I think that killing him would be conducive to the common good.
Your religion, sire, your mercy, and your bloodline call for your sparing of your brother.
Shaista Khan.
Prince Dara will be a hanging sword while he lives. Murad is no threat. He can waste in prison for as long as it takes. But Dara. Dara inspires love. And love, as we know, is dangerous. Sire, we cannot simply kill Dara. The crowds have seen and screamed for him.
He is a threat to my rule.
Beheading a popular rebel makes us feel safe, temporarily. If you killed him in battle, this question, how would it be were Dara emperor, would not prevail. But execute him as a political prisoner, and that question would fill people's minds for the length of your time.
How do we quell such doubts?
If you'd allow Mullah Farooq to speak.
Your thoughts, Revered Maulana?
Your Majesty, you are the highest embodiment of knowledge on religion and warfare.
Not over salty, nor too sugary.
You have defeated Dara. Politically, he is isolated. The governors and gentry are with you. Physically, he is imprisoned. Yet, there is a piece of ground where he remains undefeated.
Which ground?
The high ground. He is morally strong. His search for the commonality between people can make him seem saintly.
Saint? His eclectic laissez-faire attitude sickens me. I'm surprised he didn't call his sons Deepak and Richard.
Unfortunately, however, people adore him. It's not just his physical form that must perish, but also his mythology.
How?
Were it proven that Dara defied not only a brother, but flouted God himself, an Islamic ruler would be invoked to take serious action.
though the Quran advises us not to sever ourselves from our family.
The greater divine injunction would speak to Dara's desertion of Islam, were it proved that he no longer upheld Islam's supremacy and could therefore be called an infidel.
Mullah, how much evidence is there for such an accusation?
Act 3, Scene 1. Agra Fort. Afia approaches Iqbar with a tray.
I hear Dara is going to court.
There is no limit to what families do to one another, so much crueler than they are to strangers.
What does the emperor think?
Who, Aurangzeb?
Shah Jahan.
He is not emperor anymore. You can stop calling it that.
It's a difficult habit to break. Does this smell odd to you?
Iqbar sniffs the food.
This plate. The other is for Jahanara.
Smells fine.
Maybe I'm being suspicious. We don't need this separate cook. The kitchens can manage perfectly well, but the instruction came that the emperor...
Who?
Aurangzeb's baba needed separate food because of his age and infirmity.
As if diet could cure failing eyesight and insatiable desire for coitus.
Not something you suffer from. The eyes nor the other.
I am not fully a man. You know that.
Some girls wouldn't care. They'd be happy just to be held.
Nor are my eyes blighted. You are a very beautiful girl, Afia.
Afia steps toward him. He backs away.
I cannot.
When Mumtaz Mahal was alive, Shah Jahan was more moderate, wasn't he?
I mean, she did have 14 pregnancies.
Poor queen.
How are you two without their father?
I don't see them enough, but my mother manages.
If there's anything I can do.
No. I shouldn't worry about the food.
If Aurangzeb was poisoning his father, Afia, I wouldn't care.
That's not true, Iqbar. God, you talk such nonsense.
No, I don't.
You bathe his eyes each morning.
So? Shah Jahan has earned his son's hatred, but Jahanara samples everything. Go back to the kitchens, try it on one of the dogs.
They're expecting their lunch.
They are prisoners. They must abide by our schedules now.
I can't help pitying them.
Because your heart is soft, Afia. May it always remain so.
In Act 3, Scene 2, Jahanara comes to beg for Dara's life. Aurangzeb says it's in the judge's hands. Act 3, Scene 3. Courtroom, Delhi, 1659. The room is full of men. Up behind the marble screen are the shadows of women. Dara is brought in, both hands and feet fettered.
Court commences. Counsel bringing the case against the accused, stand. Counsel defending the accused, stand. You're defending yourself, Prince? He's defending himself?
I am, Your Honor.
We can't have him like this. Remove the leg restraints, but keep the hand fetters on.
Guards release Dara from his place.
Stand the prince there. Today, the 29th of August, 1659, Prince Dara Shikoh is here to be tried for the crime of apostasy punishable by death. We will test the accused's acceptance or disavowal of the superiority and definitiveness of Islam. Ready to proceed?
Affirmative, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor.
I call the counsel for the prosecution. Your first witness?
My one and only witness, the accused.
A busy day for you, Prince. On to the witness stand. Do you swear by Allah to tell the truth and only the truth in this court?
By Allah, I do.
Prosecutor, proceed.
Thank you. When a man willfully strays from Islam, it is the most profound defection. When this man is a prince, for so many years the crown prince, admired by every child in the empire, such deviation is unpardonable. Left to his own devices, this particular man could mislead every subject in this land. My prediction for today is that we will expose that the accused, standing here,
is every last inch the living embodiment of this perilous desertion.
Proceed.
Without further ado, let us open with the first blazing fact against the accused. You went to some lengths, did you not? Prince Dara, engaging the help of Hindu pundits to translate certain Sanskrit texts into Persian, texts which you have blithely called God's most perfect revelation. I refer, of course, to the ancient Hindu writing, the Upanishads. Can you confirm you had these works translated?
I can.
Stories passed down from Hindu to Hindu.
The most wise offerings,
what
yes.
What exactly is it that they reveal?
You've not read them, Prosecutor?
No, I am a Muslim.
I did not know that being a Muslim meant being ignorant of other cultures.
Tell us, since you're such an avid reader of them, about the Upanishads, Prince.
They are philosophical discussions about God's universe. They speak of our physical, astrological, and spiritual worlds being linked. They predate the Quran, and I am convinced that they are one of the blessed books referred to in the Quran.
Convinced are you?
The hidden source of the Quran acknowledges as being the fountainhead of monotheism.
Monotheism predating Islam.
And all the Abrahamic faiths.
Making Islam simply another in a long line of religions, Prince Dara.
Not simply that to me, Prosecutor, seeing as it is my religion.
You should not be the judge of that day.
There's an appreciative murmur from the benches.
As we will illustrate, your interests flail around so wildly, Prince. You seem unable to stick even to monotheistic religions. One god, several hundred, you're not particular. Tell us while we're on the matter, is it or is it not true that you are a self-proclaimed friend of this new cult religion, the Sikhs?
I am sympathetic to their beliefs. If that casts me as a friend, then yes.
Their beliefs being something of a hybrid, a bit of a Hinduism, a pinch of Islam.
The best of both.
Oh, so we can pick and choose from God's words, can we? Improve on his universe?
The Quran has everything, is everything, but I do not also appreciate the value in it, but I do also appreciate the value in the Hindu texts. The Sikhs, young as they are, look to both these magnificent religions for guidance and inspiration. Accept his will, be humble, be courageous.
Dara should go tell us, are you a secret Sikh?
No, I am a Muslim who recognizes that other religions have value.
Equal value to Islam?
I cannot say equal, yet ultimately they lead to the same understanding, or very similar.
There's a ripple through the court.
As anticipated, my witness is providing all the evidence against himself that we could possibly wish.
What kind of evidence, Prosecutor? A sign of religious knowledge that can only count against me when looked at from a deficit of reading and imagination?
I advise you, Prince, to hold your tongue before you insult me further. What you say here in court, and have said every day of your life since you were a teenage, is blasphemous and a deviation from the path of Islam.
It is not, and furthermore, you and your cronies have been stacking ammunition against me, twisting each word I utter every day of my life since I was a teenage prosecutor, Talib.
You can explain yourself further when you are running your defense. Right now, it is the prosecutor's line of questioning.
Thank you, Cousin. Let's speed on past countless other heretical translations, the Bhagavad Gita itself, for example, to which we can return if the need presents itself, and attend to the accused's own written works. The Mingling of Two Oceans. This book was offered by you?
It was.
Mingling?
The commonality between Islam and Hinduism.
Islam and Hinduism being the two oceans?
If you like.
I don't like. Am I the only one here for whom that idea seems strikingly similar to the aforementioned Sikhs? To mingle, or should we say mangle, different religions? To imagine that Islam takes its place alongside Hinduism or any other Sikhs?
This is fact, Prosecutor. Ours is one of many different systems of faith in the world.
So you believe, frankly, Prince, that the Hindu faith is as valid as the Muslim faith?
Do a Hindu, yes.
Therefore, Islam is not supreme.
There's a commotion as Sapir is brought into the courtroom in chains.
Sapir!
I wasn't able to run anymore, Father. I'm sorry.
They hurt you? Did they hurt you?
He addresses his last question to the marble screens where the women are. The court murmuring turn to look at where he is looking.
Silence in court!
Sit the boy down.
I have not seen my son, Kazi, since being captured.
Sapir is forced to sit down.
Now is not the time for a reunion, Prince Dara. Prosecutor Talib, please continue your questioning.
Prince Dara, let me ask you once more, now that the latecomers have settled. Is Islam supreme?
Who cares which door you open to come into the light?
The Qazi here cares. Your son, Prince Sapir, appears to care. And I would be most surprised if our honorable emperor did not care. La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. Yet for you, any door will do. In your book, which I have read, you posit that Hinduism and Islam share so many characteristics that they could almost be yoked. Tell us, Prince Dara, as we would dearly love to know, how can Islam, our monotheistic, single-pointed religion, mingle with a religion which worships cattle and has endless numbers of gods? There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger.
Look beneath. Beyond the glaring separation, you will discover the same desire to know God, the same attempt to live better lives, to help us reach meaning. Examine the impulse behind their systems. Prosecutor, the religions share utterly an understanding of what it is to be human.
A human Muslim, a human Hindu, or a human Sikh?
Prosecutor Talib, explain to us what is the difference.
From behind the screen, there is a haughty laugh. Sounds distinctly like Rosh Hashanah era.
So, you could just as easily call yourself a Hindu or a Sikh.
Of course, I couldn't, because I am Muslim, and my humanness is shared with anyone and everyone. If we choose to love one special person, does it mean that they are the only person worth loving? To you, your religion, to me, mine. There is no obligation in religion. Straight from the Quran, we cannot force our religion upon others.
Can't we?
We reach for God because we want to, because he shapes our lives. There should be no coercion in worship.
Oh, so we should do what we like. Pray when we want and not when we don't want.
Who said discipline is not useful? I only say that our duty as Muslims, whose God tells us there is no obligation in religion, is to allow all faiths to flourish. Is that not what our empire is built on? The very reasons the Mughals are great. We were the minority. Who are we to march into new territory and impose our creed on a massive majority of different faiths? Babur knew that. Akbar the Great knew it. Jahangir knew it. They each had weaknesses, but they all embraced the range of beliefs within their empire. Babur, founder of it all, banned cow slaughter in Delhi out of respect. Shahanjar's own mother was Hindu. Open-mindedness is well sprung of who we are, and what an empire. Our monuments, our paintings, books to die for.
Prophetically spoken.
Our music, the expression of our humanity, have poured forth from variety. Akbar's genius was to harness different traditions, as his reward was vibrant, prosperous kingdom. Akbar made his governors read poems by Rumi.
Sorry to interrupt your diatribe, Prince, but let me ask you directly. Are you a polytheist? Do you, like the Hindus, worship many gods?
One god. Your god.
Mine is not easily mistaken for a Hindu or a Christian god.
Allah is God of all, not just the Mohammedans. It is revered to me by inspiration that your Allah is one Allah. Who spoke this, prosecutor?
I am the examiner.
Answer the accused's question, if you don't mind.
Muhammad, may the peace be upon him, who also said that two religions cannot coexist in the Arabian Peninsula.
But that is a survival argument, not a spiritual one.
Are you calling Muhammad, peace be upon him, a strategist?
Of course, partly. Muhammad, peace be upon him, said those things in a single moment. And he admitted himself he was but a man.
This produces gasps from the mullahs.
Now you reduce him to mortal status and call him fake? Is that how you feel about the Quran, Prince Dara? Do you consider it secretly made of dispensable ideas?
I'm worn down and my heart is full. Please forgive my inadequacies in expressing myself. I struggle with describing my faith to others.
Never mind that you've written hundreds of poems on that matter.
I cannot undo Allah as I do. He exists in every single cell of my being. He is my entirety. I am a drop, and he is the sea.
Which sea, Prince Dara?
It is undermining to Allah to imagine he refuses people because of the path they walk to him.
If anyone desires a religion other than Islam, never will it be accepted by him, of him, and in the hereafter he will be in the ranks of the losers.
Muhammad, may peace be upon him, had to be extreme in that moment. He was building his religion.
This is the Holy Quran we are talking about. God's word. What are you saying, Prince? Careful now. Are you proposing that the Quran is not the word of God?
I propose no such thing.
You imply that it was subject to the will of man, to Muhammad's, may peace be upon him, fluctuations, inferring that the Quran itself has mutability.
Of course. The Quran is word of God because it comes from that place, which is the heart of the world. But as a document, it is also bound by the specifics of the time and place from whence it sprang.
Father.
The Arab desert is not a mobile city.
Do go on.
The Quran is a text that will last forever, serving us all to the end of life. But Allah works in mysterious ways. He is living in his he is lively in his endeavors to touch us. He shifts form. He reaches through time across latitudes, reshaping his teachings, sculpting it according to our needs. If we do not accept other faiths, we destroy the foundation of religion itself. They are the different pigments used by a divine painter, which means that whomsoever we are, if we are still enough or curious enough, we come to know Allah.
You call it stillness to sample the gamut of religions like a bee in the spring.
Prosecutor, at the center of every blossom is honey. The rest, frankly, is ritual.
Sign your own death sentence, Prince Dara.
It was signed before I stepped in here, Prosecutor.
Moving on from your take-it-or-leave-it relationship with the Quran.
That is entirely unfair.
Paradise is where there is no mullah. Recognize your words?
Do you not agree, Prosecutor? In paradise, surely you would hope not to be told how to live by others?
Will you admit in court that you have no respect for the religious men of Islam?
Point to me which one and I'll tell you.
Don't be flattered with me, Prince. You agree with Nanak, the Sikh teacher, who said the causes, forgive me, Your Honor, but this is not my sentiment, who sit in court and administer justice, commit injustice if their palms are not greased.
Men are corruptible. Why should religious scholars be different? Guru Nanak was merely commenting on the ones who did not practice what they preach.
You very comfortably call that man a guru when the Muslim faith does not concede to such a notion.
It is difficult to grasp this world, don't you agree, Prosecutor? Even after Muhammad, God's final messenger, peace be upon him, I do believe God continued to send help, and that Guru Nanak was one such helper.
May I remind Your Honor that Nanak was a Sikh?
I know who Nanak was. I'm not asleep here.
Do you dispense of the five daily prayers, Prince Dara?
I'd never be so foolish.
Do you skip Ramadan?
Prayer and fasting are water and air to me, along with charity, these three of Allah's prayers. But what lies beneath these structures is the crucial thing.
Thank you so much for correcting my misconception. The pillars are a surplus to requirement. Why did the Prophet, may peace be upon him, pray?
I didn't mean to trivialize our desire to reach God. We grapple our passions through prayer, hopelessness, fear, hatred, feeling, well, that's all we have. Prayers turn the tide, allow us scope to appreciate others. But it is not more important than life itself. Muhammad, may peace be upon him, was the first to say, go out, give service. Piety of the heart trumps prayer, and if we are sick or cooking, man or woman, we should not haul ourselves from our beds or kitchens to pray.
Yet he never missed a prayer.
How do you know? When a woman came to him saying her husband had become so pious, he spent all night at the mosque. What did Muhammad, may peace be upon him, do? He sent the man home, telling him to spend time with his family and wife. Maybe once, twice, the Prophet, may peace be upon him, was exhausted or calming a crying child, and without it being recorded, omitted to pray.
Blasphemy!
Order!
It's unorthodox to include female heckling, but in this instance, I must concur.
Your thinking is narrow.
I beg your pardon?
Forgive me.
Go on. Tell us what you're really for.
You take these religious tenets as if they were sticks to beat us. Yet our Prophet, may peace be upon him, he could not be responsive to the circumstances which encircled him. Yet we have seized on every one of his words as relayed by other mutable men as immovable truths, frozen. We know from our own lives that as soon as we seize on something as fact, it ossifies, then becomes alien, because time changes everything. Babies become adults, water becomes desert, hatred softens. Nanak is a valuable guide because he thinks for himself, whereas the mullahs, not at all. I don't mean all. Follow the words of God as relayed by his Prophet, peace be upon him, then recorded and passed down in the sunnahs and hadiths with their different opinions and interpretations as if it were law.
It is law.
It was not offered up as such.
I'll ask you for the second time, Prince. Do you deny that the Quran is God's word?
I do not, Prosecutor. It is the ultimate gift from God. But the mullahs use its words like weapons to chastise, berate, and murder, which is not what they were intended for.
Tell us, oh wise one, what you think they were intended for.
Refrain from sarcasm in my court, Prosecutor.
Forgive me, Your Honor.
You're a Muslim. You tell us why we were given the Quran.
Am I on trial here? Is my relationship found wanting with my religion?
Unfortunately not, Prosecutor.
Order! Order in court! It is not appropriate for the witness to speak to the prosecutor in this way.
I am also the counsel for the defense, Your Honor.
Yes, 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 but not yet. Not in the same moment. Return to your questions, prosecutor.
What is the purpose of Islam?
To realize the best in ourselves.
Yet that best can be found in any old darga or temple, and Nanak is better than a mullah.
If we judge others by whether they bury or burn their dead, then religion has not worked.
I put to the court that the accused, Prince Dara, flagrantly betrays the very first pillar of Islam. There is no God but God, and Muhammad is his messenger.
In which way did I betray it? I know this with all my being. It is my search, my sole purpose. There is one God. All paths lead to him, and the Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, was his greatest messenger.
You see how he added greatest, Your Honor. Did you hear?
I did.
How can you argue with it? We are not told that he is God's only messenger. There were 124,000 messengers before Muhammad, may peace be upon him. What about Jesus and Abraham?
Show the court your hands.
My hands?
I would like to share with the court the writing on the inside of Prince Dara's ring. Take the jewelry off. Pass it to the Qazi. Tell us about the inscription on the inside.
It says God.
Does it? G-O-D?
In Arabic. And in Sanskrit.
The Sanskrit word being?
Probably.
Your Honor, the accused wears this ring, not a gift, but something he had commissioned himself, with the coverall Hindu word for master inscribed on it.
Also, Allah.
Oh, how magnanimous of you. Do you also have Allah carved into your cross, Prince Dara? The Christian cross you wear all times around your neck?
The court gasps.
Prince Dara, it is unpalatably clear from these proceedings exactly as I predicted, that you strayed long, long ago from the pure path of Islam. Fact after fact. Piece of evidence after piece of evidence. I hereby propose, Dara Shiko, that this court finds you unequivocally an apostate of Islam.
Leave the pronouncements to me, will you, prosecutor?
You are wrong, prosecutor.
He's right.
Islam is the only path I walk. I just don't reject others.
Prosecutor opens a book and reads.
What shall I do? I know not what I am. I am neither Christian, nor Jew, nor heathen, nor Muslim.
Prosecutor closes the book.
Where's the rest of the poem? That's not the end of the poem.
Thank you, prosecutor. If you have finished, I call upon Prince Dara Shiko as counsel for the defense.
Your Honor, I would like to be the prince's defense.
I beg your pardon, but are you his son?
My father will not defend himself properly.
Your Honor.
He is too honest.
You cannot change the counsel for the defense in the middle of proceedings.
No, I don't believe I can.
Sibihir is a prisoner!
Thank you, Rasha Hana, for your contribution.
I understand you are a prisoner.
So is my father, but he is defending himself.
There is a knocking from behind the marble screen.
I think you had better get on with the proceedings, Your Honor.
Thank you, prosecutor. I shall not be hurried in my own court.
If my father is to be run through by his own sword, at the very least, complete the verse that should be read.
I understand your request, Prince B.
It's too late. I've finished my questioning.
But please remain seated and do not interrupt again. Bring the prince forward.
Dara is brought forward, still in fetters.
State the name of the accused.
Prince Dara Shikar. See what I mean about an empty trial?
Counsel for the defense, would you like to start by reciting the remainder of your poem as part of your testimony?
I thank you, Qazi, though I fear we are beyond that.
Say it, Father.
Silence in court!
If my poem places me here, I am in brilliant company. Islam's most revered poets would be in the dock. Rumi, Ibni, Abi.
Speak the rest.
Stop the boy from crying out.
Zapir is stunned.
Proceed.
With respect, Your Honor, this whole trial is meaningless. You and I are both pawns. This is between my brother and myself. A boy who, age 15, stood his ground in front of a raging elephant without so much as flinching. I have underestimated him, and I fear I am lost. Can you hear me? Aurangzeb?
The Emperor is not present.
Oh, but he is.
The court whispers, ripple of energy running through them as the proceedings taking this unprecedented turn.
Quieten down in court! Your defense, please.
I know you're concealed, peeping through the lattice with our sisters and the other women. I feel your eyes on me. The prophet, may peace be upon him, never dreamed women would end up obscure behind screens, beneath veils. His wives needed privacy. Their home was filled with so many people, commensurate with his situation. He suggested the hijab.
Is this relevant to the case?
Maybe, maybe not. But for better or worse, I am my own counsel. I am trying to illustrate how the Prophet's circumstances, peace be upon him, are not ours. You see, Aurangzeb, all it was that others wanted to emulate his wives. And why wouldn't they? Aisha, Zainab, Safiya, worthy, honorable women, wearing the veil made others feel like the chosen ones. So the hijab was born. It became a tradition, evolved through necessity, not God's thoughts, certainly not his instructions. And Aurangzeb, some of these traditions you take as truths are stifling.
Apostasy!
And what's more, brother, I hated you for it. My heart has struggled to love you as you have struggled to love me. But Allah is life.
Really, really, I have to stop you. This is not some gathering of whirling dervishes.
We were dervishes. We would whirl ourselves out of our heads and into our hearts, rendering these proceedings utterly redundant.
Your Honor, the council is meandering. I cannot see.
Do you remember the tiger and the goat, Aurangzeb?
Christensen. I must stop you there, counsel. You are straying from the point.
I have the decency to let me finish. Remember, Aurangzeb?
Proceed. Though if you think the emperor is listening to you, you are abused.
You would not miss it for the world. Aurangzeb, remember how fascinated grandfather was with animals? What he loved most in this world was alcohol and creatures. He hunted, he painted, and devoured them. So when he heard about the goat living with a tiger in a cage, do you remember? He was captivated, and he had this goat removed. We all watched the tiger become disconsolate, pacing the cage, growing in anguish. Then Jahangir had another goat brought in, of a similar size and shape. The tiger approached the new goat, sniffed her, promptly broke her neck, remember? Hmm. We saw the broken goat being carried out like a rag. Then Jahangir put in a sheep, which lasted minutes before being killed and consumed. Then finally, the first goat was brought back in. You remember what happened? The tiger rolled over, exposing its belly. The goat climbed on him and let him lick its face till it shone. What do you think, Aurangzeb? When we were boys, do you think the tiger was weak and the goat divine? Or do you swell with gratitude knowing that in this world, against the odds, were tigers who loved goats and goats who loved tigers? You knew what it was. You understood how it was for love to transcend boundaries.
There's shuffling from behind the screen.
Like the elephant and the blind man, where one finds a trunk, one an ear, the other a leg, so they conclude that each encountered an entirely different beast. Did their blindness make the elephant not an elephant? Aurangzeb, love exists. Possibility exists. Harmony exists. And if it weren't blind, we would see it. You and I, Aurangzeb, as Rumi says, are like boats dashing together, our eyes darkened, yet we are in clear water. It is unnecessary. Love is possible. Brother, all I ask is that you show mercy to my sons.
There is a knock on the screen.
Close proceedings.
That's enough from the council now. Take the accused back.
Aurangzeb, I shouldn't have fought. I didn't want to.
Dara is put back in his hand fetters.
Can you forgive me, brother? In the 20 mentions of apostasy in the Quran, not one prescribes the death penalty.
Which Quran do you read?
The hadiths do, but they are not the Quran. Was Abdullah a prophet?
That's enough now.
How did these hadiths grow more powerful than Allah? They were men. Aurangzeb, please! Not gods!
Gods? Plural, Your Honor, do you hear that?
Allah deals with apostasy in the next world. You can be rest assured that if I were an apostate, I would be dealt with in the hereafter, but I am no such thing. There is no god but Allah, and Muhammad was his messenger.
Prince Dara, stop now! Enough! Stop!
Father.
If you kill me, brother, I forgive you, but I ask you with all my heart, do not murder my sons!
Sifar stands trying to reach out to his father. He is dragged back. There is a clattering as Aurangzeb vacates his position behind the screens. Dara tracks his course. Aurangzeb emerges.
The courtroom here today finds Prince Dara Shikoh guilty as accused of apostasy, and as such, is sentenced to death.
But you can save me, brother.
For a moment, the brothers face each other, eye to eye, before Aurangzeb leaves the courtroom with a bang. In Act 4, Scene 1, the past, 1659, Dara comes to the Darga, where music is in full swing, to see famous Sufi Mianmir. Dara is young and arrogant, wants Mianmir's blessing. Dara is insulted at being laughed at and leaves only to come back again. This time, he gets Mianmir's lesson and is truly touched.
Act 4, Scene 2, the past. Hirabai, whom we have only seen of glimpses of before, is young and real. She teases Aurangzeb.
Who's this?
She into full singing, while she minds herself stretching up to pluck a mango off a tree. Still singing, though laughter threatens to break through, she mimes or instead of seeing her as if struck by lightning, then collapsing to the ground. He comes and tickles her.
No, don't!
You are a wicked djinn, stole all my sense.
Do you only love me because you've lost your mind?
Who says I love you?
You didn't faint when you first saw me?
I tripped and fell.
Oh, it was the glare of the sun, the exhausting walk around your aunt's garden that turned your legs to soup.
I swooned at your hideousness.
Ooh.
You should have paid me to take you.
She jumps on him now. They are physical and playful with one another.
A horrible Hindu girl like me.
And your dry hair and your mean eyes.
Better not look then. Just taste.
They kiss, her hands covering his eyes.
Can you hear the blood thundering in my veins? How you tangle me so. I forget everything when I'm with you.
Do you know what else you make? What else will make you forget?
What?
Wine.
Let's
drink some wine. Let's try a sip, just one.
She gets some wine.
What are you doing?
It smells nice.
Why are you doing this?
She offers him the goblet.
Hira, I would do anything for you.
Then drink some. Drink some wine.
How does drinking wine prove my love?
Because you detest it so.
I've never tasted alcohol in my life.
Why don't you taste it now?
You lead me further and further from myself. Give it.
Okay, he takes the goblet and goes to drink from it.
That's enough, Ronzeb. I wanted to test your love, my love. Not corrupt you with unlucky liquor.
You don't need to test me. I don't want to be anywhere but with you.
Then stay. Stay always. I can't lead you from yourself, Ronzeb. You are too strong for that, my sober sweetheart.
I come from a long line of inebriates.
Your father?
My grandfather. Father quelled it himself. On marrying my mother, he emptied his entire wine cellar in the river. The wine's not the only thing he pours away.
What would you be like as emperor?
It would never happen.
Imagine it did. How would your empire look?
Calm. Like a mosque. Ordered, safe, a place for everything.
That sounds boring.
He tickles her again.
Most of your empire is Hindu.
They choose Islam, eventually. Its power, its purity, they want that security.
You're not so serene with me.
Oh, well, that's because you, Hira, are my greatest jihad.
What's a jihad?
A struggle with the lower self.
We are like two animals that shouldn't really be together.
What am I, a snake?
No, you're a tiger.
And you are...
Goat.
What if you became Muslim here?
It would make me sad. My family is Hindu, it's who I am.
I would have drunk that wine for you.
What if you became a Hindu?
I told you. You are my all-consuming, ravishing spark.
Act 4, Scene 3, The Past. Young Dara in his 20s and Shah Jahan in his prime are in the middle of a heated debate.
Being a prince is what you are born to be.
Why would a drop become a pearl when it could be part of the ocean?
What are you saying, son?
Our spiritual search is what we are born to, father. Why are we so privileged? I cannot live with it.
We have obligations beyond other people's wildest dreams. Huge weights of responsibility. Privilege is a percentage of how we live apart.
Be fakir. I don't want to be draped in pearls the size of pigeon eggs.
These are my prayer beads.
I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about me. Father, All I want is to be close to Allah.
You are my crown prince.
You have other sons! How do you ignore the fact that the Prophet, peace be upon him, slept on the floor, yet we Islamic rulers sit on golden thrones? The Sufis stay true to him. They give everything away. But when I give the shirt off my back to a man who needs it before I know it, another one grows on me with golden threads and embedded with jewels. I'm not allowed to reduce myself to nothing. Good emperor? I don't want power!
You are shrewd, brave, and compassionate. Dara, you are perfect.
Father, I lack the appetite for it. Sufi love. Emperors kill.
Not always, not all of them. Not you, Dara.
How do you know that?
Because I can see how you would rule. You know how to. You know it.
Part of me wants it, but so much of me questions it, Father. I don't think an emperor is who I am.
Tell me your vision. What do you dream of?
I long to be at one with my universe.
So, unify Hindustan. Being a fakir is not an option. We shall not speak of this again.
But Father, my heart
is mine! I am your father. You are a branch of my tree to prune, nurture, or amputate as I decree.
Act 4, Scene 4, The Past. Hirabai is very sick with consumption. She is too weak to wash. Aurangzeb talks her through wudu as if they are doing it together.
Every project, major or small, we think of God, Bismillah.
Bismillah.
Hands.
He sponges her hands.
Swish and spit.
Three times.
Nose. You don't have to do the nose today. Yeah. Spread your hands ear to ear. Hairline to chin. Three times.
He bathes her face so gently, she collapses.
Hira.
She doesn't respond.
Yeah.
He tries to rouse her.
No. God wouldn't give you to me in order to take you away. He would have made me far, far stronger than I am, or I will break. Hira! Oh, my childhood, throughout my marriages, on the road with my soldiers. You were the only person who liked me, honestly, without effort. I was alone until I met you. Hira! Hira, speak. Is it the angel of death for me?
Act 4, Scene 5. 1659, Dara is in his prison cell. Dara and Sipahir await news of the trial.
Should have said the rest of the poem.
Don't tell me what I should and shouldn't do, Sipahir.
It spoke against you, out of context.
The context itself was what was wrong. I tried, Sipahir.
I know.
I saw you struggling with your prayers. You must pray, son.
Today I couldn't.
What do you mean you couldn't?
Couldn't.
What's wrong with you?
Father, let's not argue.
Whatever happens in your life, you cannot dismiss Salat.
They could come for you before dawn.
Your mother wouldn't like us to argue, would she? Friends?
They took your ring.
One day we're emperors, the next we're prisoners.
What do they want with you?
God makes us no promises, nor does he expect much in return. When they asked the Prophet, peace be upon him, which was the best part of Islam, do you know what he answered?
I think so.
To offer food and say salam to those you know and those you don't. That is all he really asks.
I worry sometimes that I don't know God.
Offer him food. Say hello. We are all full of doubts, Sipahir, whether we admit it or not. Allah knows.
Sipahir recites Dara's poem to him.
What shall I do? I know not what I am. I am neither Christian, nor Jew, nor heathen, nor Muslim.
We should
shouldn't be afraid of asking questions.
I am neither of the East nor of the West, neither of the Earth nor of the Ocean.
Nature's mint, I am not, nor the all-encompassing skies. I am not composed of earth, water, or fire. I am neither the dead clay nor the illuminating brilliance. I am not from this world, nor from that, nor from heaven, nor from hell. I am neither my body nor even myself, for I am my Lord's self. Only him I search, only him I know, only him I see, and only him I call. He is the beginning and the end. He is within, and he is beyond. Sit me here.
Yes, Father.
Tonight, would you call me Baba?
Act 4, Scene 6. 1659, Red Fort, Delhi. It is the evening after Dara's trial. Lamps shine behind water refracting the light. Loud music plays. Rishanara hosts a party. She forces one of her male servants to dance.
Dance with me, Akbar! Dance!
Ikbar, holding a box, comes in with Aurangzeb.
What are you doing, Rishanara? Stop your racket!
They stop playing.
A prince of the Empire has been found guilty of apostasy, Rishanara. It's not an occasion for dancing or singing.
We're celebrating!
You are a bloodthirsty hound. Iman, make sure they don't start again. Ever.
Certainly, sire.
That's an instruction throughout the city. No more music.
Sire.
Burn the instruments. Do as I say. What do people think? That we were given our lives to fritter them away? I am in earnest. Burn down the drum room. Sack the drummers. Burn the drums!
Have you lost your mind?
And the girls! All the dancing girls must get themselves a husband before Friday, or they will be thrown in the river. Understood?
Imad hurries the musicians out.
The choice is coffin or throne, brother. Not live in a coffin while on the throne.
Your bloodlust disgusts me. Enough to go right now. Liberate our brother.
But I'm...
What do you mean? Leave us!
She goes.
Should I spare him, Ipta?
How can I advise, sire?
How can anyone?
Prince Dara is your brother, but my experience of family is limited. I was separated from mine at a young age.
Something is on your mind. Speak.
Well, many things, but for one, if I may, sire, the musicians. Their families have been artists in this country for hundreds of years.
But India belongs to us now, Ipta.
Of course.
To Allah. Read me the letter.
Son, accept my gift of fruit with my greatest respect.
Not affection, notice. Go on.
I take responsibility for this war of succession. I acknowledge my failings as a father and urge you to accept my most profound apologies. I must ask you now, Aurangzeb, with the wisdom of hindsight, over the actions I myself took to spare Dara's life.
There we have it.
I vow to force allies loyal to Dara to desist from any adventure. Give him a house, a handful of servants, let him live.
Prepared to sacrifice his own dignity, bleeding Dara's cause as ever. I want no more of these letters. Stop his ink and paper supply, however much he needs.
Forgive me for interrupting, Your Majesty.
What is it?
Two visitors just arrived by foot. They walked all the way up especially to ask for Ikbar.
Are you expecting anybody?
No, sire.
It is definitely you they want.
Bring them in.
No, that is not necessary, sire.
I prize your fidelity, Ikbar. I didn't know you had friends beyond the palace walls.
I do not, sire. My work is my life.
Iman returned to that impoverished elderly couple. They bow deeply.
State the purpose of your visit.
Is that really you?
I do not know this lady, sire.
Standing with the Emperor!
Nor this gentleman.
I am your mother, we are your parents, Ikbar.
Bring tea.
Or Ikbar's relatives.
Look how you've turned out.
I last saw you when I was 11.
I know, son, I never forgot.
Take him are the last words I heard you say.
Son, you must understand the situation.
How dare you come to my place of work parading the scraps of your love?
The scene has drawn others to the hall. Rishanara loiters, captured by the unfolding scene.
We're not here for money,
you
son.
You sold me into slavery.
We were desperate.
My new owners fed me opium and cut off my genitals.
Son, please.
I'm sorry. Do I embarrass you? Pressed a rag soaked in boiled oil on my wounds, covered the rag in earth, and put me to bed for 40 days.
I can't bear to listen to this.
12? Two out of 12 of us survived from that batch, went on to imperial careers. No matter that I cannot expel urine like a man nor like a woman, am I embarrassing you again? My apologies. If they named me as they named the other slaves, I would not be honey-scented or fat pretty one, but half a man. You come now wanting recompense, having poisoned the roots of my life? Imad, where is Imad? Take these two to the whipping post. Tell the boys 20 lashes each.
No, Iqba.
You cannot whip your mother, Iqba.
I'll take them, Iqba.
I will give you the rupees I earned from selling the dung from my elephants, nothing more. And if you ever come near me again, here or in Agra, I will kill you.
This way.
Rishanara takes the parents off.
Excuse me, sire.
Iqba leaves. Aurangzeb looks searchingly after him, then picks up the box his father sent. Act 4, Scene 7. 1659, Dar's cell. Iqbar appears at the door with a prison guard and another man. The prison warden, Hussein, comes up behind the guard.
What's happening?
None of your business.
Iqbar, is that you?
Good evening, Master Sipahir. Prince.
Is it that bad that I have lost my name, Iqbar?
I'm afraid so, sire.
No brotherly reprieve?
The other man comes forward as he is the executioner. He expertly bundles a hood over Dara's head. Sipir fights, so does Dara.
Give me a sword!
He attacks the executioner with his bare hands. The guard and Iqbar hold him back.
Show me the way, my prophets and saints, Lord God Allah.
You will burn in the fires of hell, all of you!
The emperor does not want to know where the body is buried. An unmarked grave, understood?
Yes.
The executioner unsheaths a massive sword.
Baba!
Act 4, Scene 8. The ghost of Yurabai sings. Shah Jahan and Jahanara are in their prison quarters. It is dawn. They have been up all night. Iqbar arrives with a large box, the same one Shah Jahan sent to Aurangzeb.
You're back? What news?
I have a parcel from the emperor.
Baba, did you hear? Aurangzeb has sent us something?
A gift?
My letter worked. He has saved him.
Has he, Iqbal? Is Dara okay?
Is there a letter with it? It's heavy.
He tries lifting the box.
Iqbal?
I think it's watermelon, Hanara. From Afghanistan, maybe. Or Iran. It's too heavy for mangoes.
Is there no letter?
Do you remember how I used to call Dara my watermelon? Hmm? I can't see a thing, Jahanara.
She looks in the box.
Take your hands up, Baba.
What's wrong, Jahanara?
Shah Jahan opens the box again and peers in, his head right in the box.
Oh, God. Oh, God, forgive him. Forgive him.
Afia runs in.
Iqbar. What did you do? What did you bring them? Don't shake me off. What have you done?
I let you down, Afia.
No.
You know the poem in the water garden?
On the wall?
Afia!
If there be paradise on earth, it is this. It is this.
Afia!
It is this.
Wait for me. Don't go anywhere.
I can't, Afia.
Afia!
They need you. Go.
Iqbar!
I'll wait.
Promise.
Promise.
She goes back to Jahanara and Shah Jahan. Iqbar unwinds the scarf from around his jacket, makes it into a noose. He searches above his head for something to hang it on, finds it. Hira sings. Act 5, Scene 1. A week later, the the call to prayer sounds, bold and beautiful. Aurangzeb returns from Friday prayers at the big mosque with his retinue. The fakir sits on the steps.
Move the fakir off.
Get along there. The emperor's coming.
That's why I'm here.
You are deluded if you think you will converse with a half-naked heathen.
Are you so dense as to not yet understand that we are brothers? We are carved from the same wood, you and I, Marat.
Your religion bears no relation to mine.
Sufism is the kernel of Islam, the inner Islam. You cannot shake a brother off however you'd like to. Siblings are siblings.
The mullah gives his stick to Imad for him to use it on the fakir.
Get out, why don't you, religious man?
I know this character.
Emperor, we meet again. Your self-loathing is as acute as it was on the first day of our acquaintance. I should have let your father take my life that day instead of playing my part in who you've become.
How dare you place your unclothed body at the foot of this mosque?
Built by your poor father, Aurangzeb.
Cover yourself up!
Do the innocent go naked? Do you think you can obscure yourself beneath these clothes?
Public nudity breaks the law. Take him in.
Better tell babies to be born fully dressed than emperor. Make the animals wear hijab.
Take him to the floor.
Hide the face.
Put him in the dungeons.
Stop him speaking!
You will never get on
our princes! And yet you speak our transcendent words 5 times a day. Careful with that blanket. It's covering your nakedness.
Imad lifts the fakir's blanket up. Aurangzeb immediately stumbles. Imad drops it again.
I see you see them, Aurangzeb. Some already gone, some to come. I warned you.
As fakir speaks, ghosts from Aurangzeb's past are released. They stand, clustered, to haunt him. Some we know, some we don't.
Baby brother Murad, poisoned in prison. Itbar, whose soul you fouled with the task you set him, kept out of paradise by Allah. As we are told in the Quran, every suicide burns in hell's fire forever. Your nephew, Sivihir, still in your dungeons, but you know that young man's fate already, don't you? Your brother, Dara, whose head you sent in a box.
Prepare a case of apostasy against him.
Apostasy? Am I to be killed as a non-believer? I see through it. Whatever disguise you take, Allah, my love, I recognize you still.
He is hauled off.
We must clean this city up. We will not sit exposed on the mosque's steps. We will purge this empire of its vices. Round up the liquor sellers, cut off their hands and feet if they've not stopped selling within a month. Tell the imperial gardeners to plant no more roses. Ban the use of silk, cotton, only cotton. All those dargas. Ban women from going inside. We must tax all non-Muslims. We will force conversions. You cannot lead if you cannot kill. I am Allah's servant, and nothing will stand in the way of my humble, loving design.
Act 5, Scene 2. A jump forward in time. It is 1707. The ghosts are gathered like a flock of birds, hovering close to Aurangzeb. The fakir has joined them. Hira is there. Aurangzeb ages in front of us. He is 89 years old. He is sick, his back bent. Kam, Aurangzeb's youngest son, and Azam, his spirited third son, appear in his tent.
How are you, father?
Fighting fit. I need your agreement, boys. You won't leave this place until I have it.
Of course, father.
Azam.
I'm your servant, father.
You. Azam, I need you to go to Bijapur.
Bijapur?
And Khan, you must go to Malwa. You'll go straight away tonight, understood?
Malwa?
Complain if you will. You'll be there in 2 weeks. I've just been told to travel hundreds of miles.
Don't grieve me, Azam. You've given your word.
I can't pretend that I don't regret it now.
It is better this way.
Better than what?
Your tongue is sharp, Azam, and your thoughts are sharper. Hear me clearly. I do not want to see either of you again. Make your men make a sound life.
Then who will rule after you, father?
Khan draws his sword at the audacity of his
brother. No. Put your sword away! I will not have fighting at my bedside, brother pitched against brother. It's ungodly. Keep distance between you. I need your word.
Promise me. I promise.
so delicate that a king's jealousy can be aroused by a brother or even his shadow.
Who is your shadow?
It will not be drawn, Azan.
Well, then I will leave you to your favorite. I have a colossal journey ahead.
Azan bows deeply, kissing his father's hand.
Goodbye, brother, till we meet again.
Inshallah.
I have not the least liking for this deceitful, weary world.
God loves patience, father, and you are its embodiment. You've always told me, patience is the shield where Allah writes, victory in invisible ink.
My doggedness has not tamed the Marathas.
Are they tameable?
The empire is suffering. She has become unwieldy, our Hindustan. I strayed far from my seat of power. Money is spent on the wrong things. Do you know, I owe some of my soldiers 14 months' wages. I may as well have built mausoleum. Even the men of Mecca expect bribes these days because I bribed them once, twice. I thought it right to do these things. I misread Allah's signs.
Of course you didn't, father.
In my purse, you will find 305 rupees from the proceeds of the caps I crochet and sell. Use this, not state money, to bury this wanderer without fuss, Khan, my head bear. And then, hear me. Distribute whatever is left of my rupees to the fakirs.
But you hate the fakirs.
Hatred softens. We come with nothing into this world, but I go with a whole caravan of sins. What is it all for, Khan? Do we live merely to consume a quantity of water and fodder?
And rule enormous empires.
I find no release from labor.
You are the champion of Islam in Hindustan, father.
Come, after me comes chaos. 17 princes of eligible age. So, may I ask you something?
Of course.
Am I lovable?
Father.
Are you able to love me?
Tom kneels and presses his head against his father's hand.
You look just as I did as a boy. I swore that when I became a father, I would not have a favorite. Get out now, boy. Leave me. Leave. Leave. Leave!
Hereby sings softly to Aurangzeb.
Allah was kind when he lent me you, Hira. I must have pleased him at one time, but then he took you. Would you do something for me, Hira? Would you? Speak to Dara for me. I want you to ask him if he will intercede for me with Allah. I'm so thirsty.
He looks into the light.
Dara. As you said, we were boats dashing together. My darkened eyes did not see your light. Whatever the wind, brother, I am launching my boat on these waters.
The end.
Security hasn't shown up yet. We go with the spirit of life. And maybe they can be Marvin and Jade and Oscar, if you want to come for a short discussion. We have the time. And again, congratulations to you and to the great cast. Thank you for all this.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Shite and Oscar, this for a wonderful experience, really deeply moving. It's hard to know where to begin. Let me just begin with my first impression when I came in before the reading had even started. The first thing that struck me was how many people there are here. It's wonderful to see a historical play with the kind of richness in character that this has, and this is something that Oscar knows as well as anyone is very hard to do in the dramatic world today. It's a bold thing to do. It may be that that it is somewhat easier. I'm just really talking about the imagination and the scope of the play. This is the kind of thing that, on the whole, American authors do not do now. Both the range and the scope of it, and alas, the political engagement of it. It seems to me that you've created a kind of character now that really has a kind of Shakespearean feel about him. The kind of drive, the arc of his career, and the.